Okay, thank you to be here. I am Maria Soto Bucutaro. I am professor in Sorbonne University. And we are here to listen to Daria Georgiana Popescu, that will present her PhD work. So in front of the jury, very large jury, different jury. The jury is composed of the reviewers of this PhD thesis, which are Gustavo De Veciana, who is in a video today with us, and Constantin Avrachenko from Ilya Sofia. The examinators of this thesis are starting from my right, Anastasios Dovanidis from Sorbonne University,
SNRS,
yes, Bernard Moss from Sydney, Macquarie University, Luis Guillermo Zeda Garcia from Nokia Bell Labs. And now it's an honor for me to present the directors of this PhD thesis. I will start with the younger one. And Bartolomé Blaszczyński from Iria. So, Georgiana, you have 45 minutes to present.
Thank you. So, dear jury, dear audience, thank you very much for being here today. I am Daria Georgiana Popescu, and I will present today the work conducted under the supervision of my PhD advisors, Philippe Jacquet from Nokia Bell Labs and Bartek Blaszczyński from INRIA, with the title Hyperfractals for the Modeling of Wireless Networks. So we believe that the Internet of Things will generate a fourth industrial revolution that will make industries more efficient, people's lives easier, and cities smarter. Today we're going to be in the smart city where we will have new hybrid communication scenarios, hybrid in the sense that we will have communications between different entities, like drones that will be talking with buildings, buses that will be talking with bus stops, people that will be talking with ambulances, cars that will be talking within each other, within traffic, with traffic lights, with traffic poles, and so on. So a very important part in the communication is the smart city is played by the vehicular networks, which are also called the 5G verticals. So if we look at the family of vehicular communication networks, we can recognize several types of communication scenarios. First of all, we have the vehicle-to-vehicle communication, which we also call V2V. Second of all, we will have vehicle-to-infrastructure communications. The infrastructure can also be called roadside units. This type of infrastructure we will call V2I. And the third case of communications is when vehicles can talk to any other kind of entities, and that we will call vehicle-to-everything or V2X. These are the communication types that we're trying to model today. And specifically, we're working inside the smart city. So let us look how propagation looks inside a city. We're talking about urban environment. So urban environment, we are inside the city. We have streets and buildings. The signal that is propagated from a mobile node on a street will propagate along the street as the street acts as a waveguide, and the buildings have strong blocking effects. That means, actually, that a mobile node that sends a packet on a street will not be received by another mobile node that is placed on a parallel street or even a perpendicular street. This is what we call the canyon effect, which is a propagation effect specific for urban environment, and it's very strong in particular where we're walking in high frequency bands. What we're talking today is about millimeter wave bands. As you can see here, the measurements at 28 gigahertz. So given this propagation phenomenon that happens inside the city, what is our problem? Well, the problem is that the models used today are no longer sufficient for the new communications scenario. Let us see with what these models are. One of the very commonly used models inside the simulators in particular is the Manhattan grid. The Manhattan grid actually states that the nodes are regularly placed on a lattice. We can imagine either inside intersections or with a uniform density on streets. Obviously, this is not a correct correct characterization of communications inside the smart city, of topology, as not all the streets are equally dense populated. Another model that is commonly used is the Poisson point process model. Poisson point process is commonly used because we can do nice computations using the Poisson point process. And it has nice properties. One of the nice properties that we exploit is the stationarity. An intuitive way of explaining stationarity would be that placing a ball inside the window of analysis, the average number of points inside the ball does not depend on the location of the ball. Keep this in mind, as it's a notion that we will use later on. What is the problem with the Poisson point process? Well, it's obviously not fit for vehicular communications in urban scenarios. Cars are located on streets. Therefore, they cannot be uniformly placed in the space like a Poisson point process. Common literature also looks at very specific scenarios for vehicular networks. There are a lot of studies that treat the situation of intersection, propagation of packets inside intersection. This is, as you can realize, a very local and very specific scenario and does not quantify the phenomenon happening inside the whole smart city. On the other hand, we have the situation of the highway, which is commonly used for platooning, but it's mostly characterizing the communications on vehicles in between cities, not inside the city. So let us further look what's happening inside with the vehicular traffic inside the city. This is a snapshot of an annual average traffic flow inside the city of Seattle. So you will see that the streets grow in the drawing, the streets grow in width with the actual average traffic flow. One very easy observation to make is that the cumulated length of the streets that are densest is obviously less important than the cumulated length of the streets that are less populated. If you want to think it in an intuitive way, of course, there are boulevards inside the city, but the cumulative length of the boulevards is way lower than the cumulative length of streets and further lower than the cumulative length of alleys, while the density is decreasing. Okay? This is a very interesting observation, and none of this is captured by the commonly used models. So what we need actually is models that will respond to all the hybrid communication scenario, remember V2V, V2I, V2X, but at the same time capture all the features of urban communications, both the canyon effect, both how the traffic scales inside the city. In order to design this kind of models, we can no longer use the methodologies we had before, so we need to look somewhere else. And where we will look in nature, and we will look at fractals. Fractals are everywhere. And if you think about fractals, an abstract mathematical object, well, fractal is not just a Mandelbrot set, but you can find fractals so frequently in nature, like a snowflake is a fractal. And we are already using fractals so much for modeling in biology, chemistry, so on. For example, lungs can be modeled with fractals. And with a certain level of accuracy, we can even model the urban growth with fractals. This is a view of the city of Paris from the space, an image taken by NASA. So fractals can be models, can model cities. And furthermore, we're not the first one looking at fractals when talking about cities. Michael Batty, in his famous work, Fractal Cities of Geometry of Form and Function, is arguing that the growth of cities and the organization of the human society is self-similar. And we're not only doing that in the organization of cities and human society, but furthermore, there are already numerous applications in urban planning and urban architecture that exploit self-similarity and fractals. So some ideas are coming together already. And furthermore, some other ideas that we use is a early study that we did by using mobility traces from Köln Trace Project in the city of Köln in Germany that show that the mobile trajectory is highly influenced by the environment geometry. Obviously, cars go on streets. Furthermore, the connectivity is also influenced by the environment geometry. Another idea that we got is from studies performed by Philippe Jacquet here that has shown that the mobile positions of devices indoors, so we're talking about IoT devices, can be modeled with Poisson shots on fractal maps. So why not combine all of these objects, all of these ideas, and create a new model where we're going to do the mobility of the user on streets in between the buildings. So the contributions of the thesis that I will present today is a new model for urban communication, urban vehicular communications that will use not only stochastic geometry, but for the first time also the self-similarity, the fractals. I will also provide tools, basic mathematical tools for the manipulation of the model in the framework of a classic stochastic geometry. Also a procedure for the computation of fractal dimension from traffic flow maps. And I will showcase the utility of the model by studying typical wireless network metrics. So now that we're talking about fractals, let us give some more intuitions about these notions. So in this image, we can see the representation of two famous fractals, the contour sets. First representation is the contour set in two dimensions, and the second one is in three dimensions. How we obtain a fractal? Well, how we obtain the contour set in two dimensions, for example? We start with the object at the first iteration. We have just a square. At the second iteration of the contour set, we obtain four squares. Each of the square is a perfect copy of the original square, the original set, but with a certain shrinkage and with a certain shift. We repeat the operation on and on and on, and here we obtain the contour set. An ideal fractal exists only in the infinity. In reality, when we're using fractals, we're going to stop at the level that is relevant for our computation and for our application. In particular, in simulations, we will always stop at a certain level that is sufficient for our level of accuracy. Do keep in mind that each item obtained at the second iteration and the third iteration is a copy of the first one with a certain shift and a certain shrinkage and a fine transformation. This is the self-similarity property. So how do we quantify this self-similarity? Well, for that, we're going to use the fractal dimension. There is no general definition for the fractal dimension, yet the fractal dimension has a very intuitive way of being found. Now, let me give you the intuition between the computation of fractal dimension by looking at two examples, one that's not a fractal and one that it is. So let us look at this. It's supposed to be a square. It looks more like a rectangle, but let's imagine it's a square. So if we split the square on each of the sides with a factor of half, we will obtain four squares, right? So half of the side at the power of the dimension, and we obtain 1/4. That gives us the dimension. It's exactly 2. It's exactly the Euclidean dimension, the space where we're working. It is not a fractal. Let us look on the other side at the Sierpinski triangle, the Sierpinski gasket or sieve. It's a famous fractal. Here, if we split the side of the Sierpinski triangle on each of the sides of 2, what we obtain? We obtain 3 sets. So the fractal dimension in this case would be 1.580 something, which is, first of all, smaller than 2, the dimension of the embedding space. Second of all, it's not an integer, it's a fraction. That's why we call it a fractal. So a very intuitive way of defining the fractal dimension is first, we denote the number of the disjoint subsets where of the set can be divided in 2, and by using also the magnification factor, we define the fractal dimension of the logarithm of the sets over the logarithm of the magnification factor. So here, for the square, we had logarithm of 4 over logarithm of 2, and for the Sierpinski triangle, logarithm of 3 over logarithm of 2. So now that you have a short overview of fractals and self-similarity, let us go into our model, which would be the hyperfractal model. So let us start with the support. The support of cars are streets. We shall start with the support, which we denote with psi. The support will remind you of a Manhattan grid. It is not limited to this kind of shape. Let us further see how we build it. So in the first stage, we will draw a cross that splits the space in 4. And furthermore, we will continue. In the second stage, we'll draw 4 more lines. Notice that the second stage, the length of the lines is higher than the length of the lines in the first stage. And furthermore, we will create actually 4 crosses that are the exact copy of the original cross with a certain shrinkage and a certain shift. In the third stage, we build even more lines. And do observe that the support is becoming denser and denser, and we're working in a bounded window. This structure reminds of a space-filling curve. Okay, these are our streets. Let us talk about the cars on the streets. How do we model them? So we have a total budget of nodes to place on the streets. We will start by, maybe I should put the, okay. Sorry. Okay, we should start by sampling the total number of points from a Poisson distribution and place each point on the central cross with probability p. So in the end, p% of the nodes would be placed on the central cross. In the second stage, what is left from the total population will be equally split between the 4 quadrants. And again, we will do the same. It's like a fractal. On each of the crosses, we will place p% of the total points that were allocated for that quadrant on the cross, and so on and so on. In the third stage, we will go in each of the 4 quadrants of the 4 quadrants, and on each of the lines, we will place points with probability p, and so on and so on. What is nice is to observe that we will obtain a process with one-dimensional density. It will be a Poisson process on lines. On the other hand, let us see how we compute the fractal dimension of this structure. Well, just like we did for the Sierpinski triangle, if we split the side of the hyperfractal with 1/2, what we obtain is 1 minus p over 4 of the total population of the hyperfractal. So what we obtain is the fractal dimension is, this time, something higher than 2, the Euclidean dimension of the embedding space. Well, that is why we won't call it a fractal, but a hyperfractal, because it is higher than 2. Furthermore, we will ask why it is higher than 2, while all fractals are smaller than 2. Well, because fractals are sets, and we're actually working with a measure. A nice observation to make is that, remember we were talking about stationarity. The Poisson process has a stationarity. Well, if we place a ball here inside the hyperfractal, the average number of points will depend on the position of the ball. So we do not preserve stationarity, which makes the analysis a little bit complicated. Yes, yet we will provide some tools that will help you further work with the hyper factor. One notion that is very important when dealing with point processes and models is providing the notion of the typical point, which we will find an intuitive way by just looking at the construction process and how the points are set on each of the levels. Well, in order to further validate our definition of the typical point, we shall use two notions that are commonly used in stochastic geometry, which is the Campbell-Mekke formula and the mass transport principle. The Campbell-Mekke formula is commonly used for the computation, for example, of the shot noise or the interference. We obtain it by using Campbell-Mekke for non-stationary process and by the very nice fact that we actually have Poisson distribution on lines. Why do we like the Campbell-Mekke formula? Why? Because it's a very nice way of computing the effect of the function of a function, for example, on the whole process by just looking at the effect of the function on the typical point and then multiplying with the number of points inside the process. Furthermore, the fact that we are able to compute Campbell-Mekke for this hyperfractal sustains the existence of the typical point, our definition of the typical point. Maybe we should turn the light on? No? Okay, or not me, okay. Another notion that will sustain our definition of the typical point is the mass transport principle. Mass transport principle comes from graph theory, and so it's 20 minutes? Okay, it comes from graph theory, and it's translated to the point process theory. And it's a very nice notion as well, as it allows us to compute rate. Again, mass transport principle, the fact that we are able to have it for the hyperfractal sustains our definition of the typical point. Good. Now that you have some notions of how we could manipulate the hyperfractal, we should look at something else that is very important when introducing a new model, which is model fitting. So let us look again at the map of Seattle. I told you that in the map of Seattle, we will have this cumulated length of the streets that are very dense, that is smaller than the cumulated length of the less populated streets. Well, that's how we actually build the hyperfractal. And if we look at the quantization of the streets, it's done in a similar manner. So the procedure of transforming the traffic flow maps to hyperfractal is done based on the property of hyperfractal, meaning that we will rank the streets in a decreasing order. Just look at the annual average traffic, weekly traffic, okay? And after we rank the streets in the decreasing order, we will compute the cumulated length up to a certain level, up to each of the level of the quantization that we're working on. We have a way of fitting the density to the cumulating length, and this is a very nice way of obtaining the fractal dimension. So for example, if we look at the map of Minneapolis, we can see that we can compute the fractal dimension to be 2.9. I'm just gonna turn on the light, or not. Good. 2.9, okay. Further examples will come sooner. So now that I have introduced the hyperfractal model, show you how you compute the hyperfractal dimension of the maps, let us see how we use hyperfractals in wireless networks. So we're gonna look at delay tolerant networks. We are only working with cars moving on the streets. So we're in the vehicle-to-vehicle type of communications. The cars will be moving with constant speed V. We will consider infinite radio range, but if you want, you can consider that the packet can arrive next to the next neighbor of the car through some prior sensing. We have the canyon effect. Remember, the canyon effect is saying that a mobile cannot communicate with another mobile that is placed on a parallel street or on a perpendicular street. That will mean that because we will not have points in intersections, it will be basically impossible for the packet to propagate from a street to a perpendicular street. That is why we have the delayed tolerant networks scenario. The packet will be able to propagate inside the network only through store, carry, and forward type of protocol. We have the hop duration time H. We perform a single hop broadcast through the nearest neighbor type of routing. And we're looking at the measured broadcast time, meaning the time that takes to propagate the packet from one point to all the networks. And then we will look at the average that is obtained by averaging through all possible sources. So how do we compute this? Well, we're working in a hyperfractal. And what did we say about fractals is that a piece at some stage is relevant for the behavior of the whole object. So we're going to zoom in and see what happens between a line that is densely populated and a line that is less dense populated. So if we want to start the infection, the contamination of the network starting from point X, and we want to see when the location, the car located at Y, it will be contaminated, we have two scenarios. Either the packet will propagate through hop-by-hop kind of propagation, jump through an intersection to delay tolerant properties, and then hop-by-hop towards Y. Either we'll do hop-by-hop again on the diverted route, jump through an intersection, hop-by-hop on the less populated route, another intersection, hop-by-hop again on the less populated route, and come back on the crowded route. There are trade-offs between these types of propagation. The hop-by-hop on the propagation on the very dense line would obviously take more time than hop-by-hop propagation on the less crowded line. But then again, we will have the time of story and forward propagation through intersections. So by analyzing these trade-offs, we're able to obtain our upper bound on the propagation time in the direct route scenario and in the diverted route scenario. Do observe that sometimes when we do perform the computation, we obtain a parameter that is delta that is a function of the fractal dimension of the hyperfractal. We can also obtain the lower bound on the average broadcast time, and it's very nice to see it that the intuition between before by computing it is by just looking that actually hop by hop on the central cross is the major term in computing the lower bound. Okay, so these bounds were validated firstly by an in-house built simulator. I have performed the simulations in MATLAB. So the simulations were performed for several values of the fractal dimension, like 3, 3.33, up to 5.33. And do notice that the values of the simulations do validate the upper and the lower, the upper and the lower bound for each of the fractal dimension and for various number of points. Do keep in mind that each time that we perform computations in a fractal or in a hyperfractal, we're computing towards the infinity. In reality, simulations always will stop at level 3 or 4 as it's relevant for a city. We always have only boulevards, streets, alleys. We don't go towards infinity with the type of the street. Good. When we perform simulations, we observe something very interesting, the teleportation effect in the hyperfractal. So why do we say teleportation? Teleportation would not be like nice quantum teleportation, but will be teleportation of information effect, meaning that we will obtain information in points where we did not expect information to arrive. So let us look how the information propagates inside the hyperfractal. For example, if we drop a packet of information somewhere here, the packet will propagate through hop by hop on the central cross, then go through intersections and go on the second level of the hyperfractal. Again, it will continue to propagate on the central cross and start infecting the other lines of the diverted route. At some point in time, it will come back on the central cross. Well, what happens here in each iteration, in each time slot? We were supposed to have two nodes that were further contaminated with information. Due to the fact that the packet arrived on the secondary route, we will have not only two more contaminated points on the central cross, but six. This is our teleportation effect, and it actually allows for a broadcast speed up. The broadcast will happen faster. So how much faster? Well, we can look at it and compare the broadcast time in our hyperfractal with the broadcast, for example, in the Manhattan grid, where we have uniform density of points on lines. So with teleportation, the number of contaminated nodes increases considerably. And furthermore, if we look just at the average broadcast time, we can see that it is much smaller than the average broadcast time in a traditional Manhattan grid type of network. We can even compute the inflection point when the average broadcast times become much smaller. Further simulations were performed also in a commercial simulator in Qualnet, which allowed us the implementation of all the specifications of 800.11p, which is the standard for vehicular communications. So we were able to specify parameters for physical layer and both for map layer. And again, by looking at the diverted route and the direct route, we can validate our bonds, again, for different values of the fractal dimension and for different number of nodes. This time, let me remind you that we have a limited radio range. And furthermore, we can even look at different speeds, a speed that can be increasing with the level. If you want to imagine the case where the network is very loaded, like the boulevards are very crowded, or the other way around, when the speed of the vehicles on the boulevard is much higher than the speed of the vehicles on the alleys due to vehicle speed limitation. Good. So now I would like to showcase a demo that I have implemented for the computation of the fractal dimension that we were talking earlier, and to check how broadcast happens in some of these maps. So if we are to choose the map of Minneapolis, we can compute its fractal dimension, transform it into a hyperfractal, and drop a packet of information and see how the information propagates inside this abstraction of the map. So for example, if we look at Seattle, with this portion of Seattle, we obtain a dimension of 2.32, and we can see how the information propagates inside this representation of the map of Seattle. Just another example with another city, this time from Canada, I think. Edmonton, right? I think it's Canada. Good. The fractal dimension of 4.2. And if you drop a packet inside of Edmonton, on the city of Edmonton, this is how the packet would propagate. So now, let me remind you that we've been talking about vehicle-to-vehicle type of communications, but we are talking that in smart city, we will have also vehicle-to-infrastructure type of communications. Because we can imagine that the vehicles can talk with roadside infrastructure, or why not, because deploying new infrastructure would be costly, exploiting the already existing infrastructure, like the traffic lights. So in this type of communications, in this type of communication scenario, we like to look at trade-offs between end-to-end energy, end-to-end delay, and transmission power. And why would we like to look at transmission power? Because we might consider that vehicles would be using millimeter wave, where the transmission power is an important fact due to its impact on human health. So let's observe how traffic lights are located in city. So if we look at the map of a snapshot of location of traffic lights in Adelaide, we can observe that, again, the traffic lights are deployed much denser on crowded streets, if you want, on boulevards and streets, and there are less and less traffic lights as we go in depth towards the alleys. That is a very good news because we can employ another hyperfractal model to for the traffic light's location. So how do we do this? We will split the plane with a line, a vertical line in two, and with a probability pi, we will place a point on the line, and the rest of the probability will be equally split between the two half planes. We will do the similar operation with a horizontal line, and what happens when you combine together is that we will have a point placed in the intersection of the two lines with probability pi square, and with the rest of probability is equally split between the lines. Well, the obtained process, which is phi r, will have a discrete intensity, which is function, of course, of the level in which we have drawn the line. But what can happen is that the process can drop points several times in the same intersection. Obviously, we do not want that. And we will only have one row side unit per intersection. And we will limit that. We will keep just one relay. Therefore, the final process that we will use for the representation of relays will be just the support measure of the original process phi r. Further details are inside my manuscript. I can only show you a representation of the complete hyperfractal maps with mobile nodes and relays. The mobile nodes are in black and the relays in red, starting from the same budget of for mobile nodes and relays. So we looked at energy versus delay in the hyperfractal V2X for millimeter wave type of communications. And some conclusions that we drew was that when we allow for the path to grow, for the end-to-end path, therefore the delay, we were talking on hop-by-hop type of transmissions, the minimum energy of the whole path will decrease. Another parameter that we looked was the path maximum energy, meaning the maximum energy with which a node is allowed to transmit inside the path. And again, when we allowed the path length to increase, the maximum path energy decreases. I will refer you to my chapter for further details. Good. So let us draw some conclusions. Time. Okay. The conclusions are that we have the hyperfractal model that not only captures numerous features of the hybrid vehicular communication scenario, both V2V, V2I, V2X. It exploits realistic features of vehicular urban communications, like the variation of density of vehicular traffic in cities, the street length, and so on. We include already in the design of the model propagation features in urban environment. And for as a new thing, it combines stochastic geometry with fractal geometry. We have provided also stochastic geometric tools to further handle the object and a data fitting procedure for you to compute the traffic dimension of city, neighborhoods, and so on. We have also showcased how the model can be used for the computation of wireless metrics of interest, like the broadcast duration, the energy delay, load, capacity, etc. So what you can do now with my work is actually take the input of vehicular traffic measurements, densities of cars and streets, and observe also lengths of streets. You can transform the data with the fitting procedure into a hyperfractal abstraction, and then simply compute the wireless metrics of interest, like in this example, the broadcast duration. Further perspectives of the hyperfractal model would be to design another validation procedure of traces for the hyperfractal model option for relays. We would like to perform further studies for millimeter wave-based LTE infrastructure, as it's very fitted to the Canyon effect incorporation. I think that it would be quite interesting to look what happens when we're not using a two-dimensional embedding space but a three-dimensional embedding space, and that can be a possible operation that can be interesting if we're working with networks of drones, or why not if we're talking about beamforming and LTE frequency bands. Hybrid hyperfractals would be interesting, meaning different ways of disposing the support. We were talking at some point about the concept of percolation in depth and the generalization of the models for nodes, as also François Bacelli is doing something similar with the Poisson-Quant process for vehicular networks. This is a list of publications I have done throughout my thesis on the subject of the hyperfractal. And I thank you very much for the attention, and I'm waiting for your questions.
Thank you very much for this very clear.